The title of his lecture is Managing Magic. At no time do his hands leave his wrist. The latest on the possible U.S. government UFO disclosure plan. Grant Cameron, come to the stage.
Thank you. Thank you, Victor. Like all the others, we've got 45 minutes, and none of us, it's like going on a diet, we don't do 45 minutes, so I may skip over some of the slides. I want to get to the very end. I've got sort of a message at the end. I'm going to do something a little bit different today. Let's get this going here. Nothing. Okay. Okay, so I'm going to do the latest on the whole story with the New York Times, the AATIP, Tom DeLonge, all this kind of stuff. I first got involved in the government aspect of this thing in 1977. I interviewed Merle Smith, who was the wife of the guy of Wilbert Brockhaus Smith, who ran the Canadian government UFO program from 1950 to 1954. So I've done this for a long time. I always call it I have the consciousness, which is the rabbit hole, and this is the rat hole. I'm always trying to get out of it, but I keep getting dragged back into it. So I'm going to go through, and what I'm going to show you today is this is really not a new story. I've described this in every lecture, and it's very important. To disclose means to reveal, and there is a revelation taking place, I believe, by the U.S. government. It is not by the Canadian government. The government is doing number two. The Canadian government is covering up. I have no idea what the Canadian government is doing because they shut up. They don't talk about it. The American government, on the other hand, is doing this gradual disclosure, not doing full disclosure. If they were going to do full disclosure, they would stand the president up and tell you what's going on. So they're not doing full disclosure, and they're not covering up, because everybody's talking. They're leaking all this stuff, and my whole contention is that they have been leaking this stuff for the last 70 years. And in Managing Magic, I talk about this. This is the Canadian government reaction to the story for the AATIP thing. The Canadian Armed Forces focuses on credible threats. We do not comment nor facilitate interviews on speculative matters such as this. And they take a Billy Meyer photograph and they put this on, and this was a CBC request for an interview. And they said, we're not going to comment on this. I maintain there's been disclosures all the way through from 1947 on. Three major disclosures I'm going to touch on today. These are three major efforts. 1974, 75, 1988, and the one that's happening right now with the New York Times, the Tom DeLonge, all that kind of stuff, and which may actually now be in Congress. Congress is looking at this issue, and I say the only difference between the 2017 now is they've learned how to do it. They're much better, and they're putting some steroids in the Kool-Aid now, and it's moving along very, very fast. And the point I want to make is this is not the first rodeo. This is not the first time they've done this. And this is what I want to get across to you. I'm going to give you some examples from the history that they've done this before. So it's not the first rodeo. There's this book written by Stephen King called Dreamcatchers. He called it SSDD. Same shit, different day. And that's what's going on here. It's the same disclosure. The Bible describes it this way. What has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. And when it comes to disclosure, this gradual disclosure thing, that is absolutely true in my experience. Managing Magic is the book where I go through year after year after year. I just go through all the years. Because when I saw the Tom DeLonge thing break, I said, they've done this before. I've been in this. They've done this before. They're doing it again. And I'm going to show you some of the stuff from the past. 1956, Walt Disney was asked to do a documentary for the U.S. government. He had done a lot of stuff for the U.S. government. They offered him all sorts of films, videos, all this kind of stuff. He did the documentary, and they pulled the films and the videos at the very end and said, we can't let you have the videos. The documentary went out. This is a 1956 documentary or a movie. It was done in Hollywood, UFO. It was UFO. U.S. Air Force consultants worked and helped put this thing together that came out in the theater. So they've been doing this. These are kind of minor examples of what's going on. Now, this is a warning. Tom DeLonge has commented on, because I've lectured about this extensively for the last year, and basically says, well, Grant isn't in the loop at TSSA, so unfortunately he reports major inaccuracies. My team is always aware of them, and we try to repair the damage when we can. I'm not in charge, don't worry about my ego. And that comes from the fact that the way I say is the government takes it, and they have people like me and all sorts of other people who believe it's their message to get out this disclosure thing, and the messiahs. And I say, if you're a messiah, you need sort of a big ego, because you're going to run into a lot of opposition. And so he didn't like my comment about the fact that he had an ego. And he said, basically, I'm not in charge. What I would say to this is, the minute that To the Stars and the U.S. government all go under oath and describe what they're doing and what has happened, and they release all the documents, I'll get on my knees, I'll pray for forgiveness, and I will change the errors. Until then, I'm going to extrapolate on the data. What you can assure from me is I'm not under any non-disclosure agreement, and I'm not being told anything by the government. What I'm saying is what I believe. Nobody's telling me to say what I'm saying. This is the guy that I believe runs the entire program. I've had interactions, and Tom DeLong says, I'm not in the loop with TTSA. I was offered to be in the loop. This is the CIA guy, Ron Pandolfi. He is the guy that supposedly holds the keys to all the classified material on UFOs. I was offered an in on their program. They're doing a disclosure. I've heard there's as many as 6 disclosure programs going on at the same time. I was offered an in on this program, and I said, I'll help you, I'll talk to you, whatever you want, but I'm not going to. This is the guy that made the offer to me, Kevin Elber. He said, you can be in, you'll be in on all the phone calls. I said, no, I don't want to be in. He said, well, if you're on the inside, you get 100%. If you're on the outside, you're going to get 10 to 15%. I said, I'll take the 10 to 15%. I'd rather be a chess player than a chess piece, because I know what happened to these people who got into these programs, and how when the program falls apart, you get holding the bag, and they just walk away into the shadows. So I was offered an in. I didn't get Tom DeLong, but I got the guy above Tom DeLong that made me the offer. Two nights ago, I have what's called a rabbit hole meeting, and anybody that wants to get in these rabbit hole meetings, what we have is, it's called a rabbit hole meeting. It's done on a Zoom broadcast. You come on, you turn your camera off, turn your audio off, and a bunch of experiences, and people come, and we talk about whatever. And Kevin Elber was going to come on this 2 nights ago, because apparently they're going to make some sort of announcement. And then he didn't show up on the broadcast, so I contacted him. It has to do with this thing that's going on in Salt Lake City. There's some sort of thing they're working on in Salt Lake City. We don't know. Some people say it's a portal. Some people say it's gravity stuff. I talked to one of Firmage's engineers. He said it's going very well. They're in the testing stage, and they were going to make some sort of announcement. He didn't show up, but he did email me and said, I don't want to talk in front of a bunch of people, but I will talk to you privately. So that conversation hasn't happened yet. I hope to have it for today, but it hasn't happened. It has to do with this thing that they're working on in Salt Lake City. Apparently, there's been almost $100 million put into this whole thing. And I did talk to one engineer who said to me, yeah, this thing's for real, and they are moving along. So Tom DeLong has problems with what I'm saying, and yet you get the other side of the story. Ron Pandolfi had made reference to the fact that I was John the Baptist, and supposedly that I'm here to open the way for Tom DeLong. So again, it comes down to, you know, what Kool-Aid you're drinking as to what your interpretation of what I'm actually doing. And so I sort of, he calls me, John the Baptist, so I sort of refer to him, because he says a bunch of stupid things. I don't know if you really know Ron Pandolfi, but he says the craziest thing. So I basically said he's like the Mad Hatter, and he's just like all this stuff he puts out, and you don't know whether it's real or whatever, but the thing is, he's this high-level guy. So I watch what he's doing. I really don't believe much, but I watch what he's doing, and I think he may be running the whole program, the whole operation. So Tom DeLong puts out a thing about 2 weeks ago, and he said, here's my team. And so I figured, well, I would do the same thing. So that's his team, and he says he's not in charge, and this is my team, and I'm not in charge either. This is at a sensitive compartmentalized facility in the Tim Hortons in Winnipeg, and we're having a meeting. Now here's Tom DeLong. Now this has come up numerous times, and people keep repeating this, and I don't really want to use the audios, but I'm going to use a couple of audios today to show you this. The story is, Tom DeLong set this whole thing up. And I'm saying, no, he didn't. It's the same story as the past. Tom DeLong was invited in. Now, it doesn't mean Tom DeLong didn't do a fantastic job with what he got when he got in the program. I'm not taking anything away from Tom DeLong, but he did not set up the program. This is how it starts. He gets an invite from Lockheed Skunk Works.
So the most classified and the most advanced group of engineers and scientists that work within the military industrial complex work under one specific group, and it's a very, very quiet group. But But for the very first time, they were doing an event where family members can come and not go in the buildings, but at least celebrate in the parking lot what their loved ones do during the day, you know. And they asked me, you know, would you come up? And because I knew this one individual that told me to be really careful, you know, he goes, hey, look, this is a way for you to come up and see a little bit about what we're doing.
So he gets the
invite.
And this
is honestly, check this out. Do you want to know why I got brought in to the most secret groups ever? Is because I went in there and I said, you know, something's wrong here. Let me tell you the way I see it. And they said, okay. I said, the way I see it is you have something flying around, and every once in a while it lands and performs a miracle.
And
it crashes in a few different places.
He gives them what's called the cargo cult theory. And he said the minute he put out the cargo cult theory, then suddenly he got the offer to move and to go to Washington, D.C. They were bringing him into the program. This is Bill Moore from the 1980s. I was with Bill Moore. I interacted with Bill Moore. This is what Bill Moore said in his being brought into the program. Exactly the same story. Identical. He said in early 1980, he's the guy that wrote the Roswell incident. You would not know about Roswell if it hadn't been for Bill Moore. He wrote the first Roswell book. He became very famous. He was this high-level considered researcher. As soon as he goes on the book tour, he's offered. They phone him up and they say, you're the only guy that knows what you're talking about. A week later, he gets another phone call from Offutt Air Force Base. They say, you're the only guy that knows what you're talking about. And he gets brought in, and he steps in, almost like Tom DeLonge does, and Bill Moore has all these people set up for him.
Bill, tell us how you first got involved.
I got a phone call after appearing on a radio show from a man who said, you're the only person we've heard talk about this subject who seems to know what he's talking about. He convinced me that he was a government intelligence agent and wanted to begin disseminating some information about UFOs to the public.
And the man Bill is referring to is Falcon, whom we've seen in shadow to protect his identity.
That's right. I didn't think that I could handle it all alone. The volume of material I was getting from Falcon was rather mind-boggling, so I got together with Jamie.
And we joined forces in June of 1982, and Falcon told us about MJ-12.
This is one of the guys that contacted him. This is significant because people sort of, they know about the government documents, they don't realize where they come from. He got one from Richard Doty, he got one from this guy, Lieutenant Colonel Ronald Evans, who was at Offutt Air Force Base. He's the guy that did the DIA report, evaluation of the Iranian jet fighter case. Now we have the Nimitz case, which is the big case. Before the Nimitz, it was this case. And he worked on it, and according to Brad Sparks, who's a pretty notable researcher, he helped leak that case, and he also helped leak the case that dealt with Loring Air Force Base, Wurtsmith Air Force Base, Minot Air Force Base, and Malmstrom Air Force Base in 1975 when I had my first sighting. There was UFOs inside the weapons storage area where they kept the nuclear weapons in these four bases along the Canadian border. He leaked that document as well. So you have these guys back then leaking this material to Bill Moore. Bill Moore, Tom DeLonge indicates indirectly that he was at Area 51. And that's where he gave the cargo cult theory, where he said they suddenly realized he was on the right track and they were going to deal with him. Bill Moore also claimed to be at Area 51. So you get George Knapp, who has broke the Area 51 story, has never been to Area 51, and you get two researchers brought on. This is a plane that Bill called the Goose that he saw at Area 51. This is where, just going fast here, hang on. So Tom gets an invite to go to the Pentagon. He gets an email 2 weeks after he comes out of the Lockheed facility where he's talking to the head people at Lockheed, and he gets an invite to go to Pentagon City, outside the Pentagon.
Things like this don't happen at the White House. They don't happen at the Hill. They happen in places like this, at tables like this, where a few men get together and decide to push the ball down the field, and then the meeting was done. I mean, done, like a movie done. So the very next day, I got sent over to NASA.
So you have the situation where he's at Lockheed. They send him to the Pentagon. He meets these two guys behind a table. They say things like this don't happen at the White House, don't happen in Congress. And then they send him to NASA. Then he goes to NASA, and he deals with the head people there. They send him to Ames. Then they send him, he goes to see a general. This is General McKay, I believe, at Colorado Springs, and with a colonel with him, and they ask, what do you need? They're asking, how can we help you? What do you need? and they start working with him. Then he has a meeting in an airport, and this Bill Moore did the same sort of thing. He had this meeting in an airport, and he's having this conversation with these two guys, and it's at that point the one guy says to the other guy, okay, introduce him to the general. So the whole idea that Tom DeLonge set this thing up, no matter what good stuff he did not set this thing up. The only person he really actually set up was John Podesta. He phoned John Podesta, and his first initial phone call where he got connected to Lockheed. So they introduced him to the general. The general is General Neil McCaslin. He's was a two-star general at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, very high-level guy. And if you look at the WikiLeaks stuff that all leaked with John Podesta's WikiLeaks, there's actually an email there where the general actually puts out information, what to do when the disclosure happens. He's telling the government what to do. This is going to John Podesta, and the general was saying, I was thinking a bit more about what the White House memo should say, something like these points to all federal agencies. And then he lists off all these things, do this, do this, do this, do this. So the general is advising Tom DeLonge to John Podesta how to run the disclosure. Once you make the announcement, what you're going to do. And then, of course, when the WikiLeaks fell apart, the general sort of disappeared. They all just sort of, I think they're still around, but the claim is that they're no longer part of the program. So he says, I was introduced to a man called the scientist, another called the general, and there are many more I cannot say much about. And then if you go back to Bill Moore and his team.
Well, so without validating it, how do you get from there to here?
Well, after hundreds of hours of research, we're working with experts trying to validate the documents. But most important, the contacts have grown to include Falcon and 9 other government agents.
And why do you believe them?
Well, because we've been able to meet with them, we've been able to check and verify credentials, and it's clear that they are in secret, need-to-know positions. Falcon's position, for example, gives him access to the MJ-12 infrastructure.
So Tom DeLonge has these people, he comes to trust these people, he vets their credentials, they're telling him stuff. Exactly the same thing happened to Bill Moore, identical. This comes down to the connection to the CIA. This is Billy Cox, who writes a blog for UFO blog. He's been writing it for 30 years or whatever. And he gets involved with UFO Cover-Up Live, which was a documentary done in 1988. I firmly maintain it was set up by the CIA. And in this documentary, he deals with Colonel Coleman, who was at the Pentagon, who was involved in this leaking this material, actually says, I met the Falcon there. He tells Billy Cox, I met the Falcon at the set. And this is this high CIA guy. This is this Harry Rositsky. You can see his book. He wrote some books on the CIA, was the head of the Russian desk at the CIA. And I phoned up Bill Moore. I said, Bill, was the Falcon in the audience at UFO Cover-Up Live? And he said, I'll just tell you this, Grant, there was 12 people, and that's as far as I'll go, which seemed to confirm, yes, this guy actually was there. And Coleman said, I could not believe this guy was involved. I could not believe that this high-level guy was involved. But he never would tell Bill Cox who it was. The guy that's running the program now, this is the guy that's running Tom DeLonge's operation, he's the director, is Jim Semivan. And what I always try to remind people is when you see these people in this program, a lot of these people are experiencers. Jim Semivan had the beings in his room in the early 1990s with his wife. He's a believer. He's trying to figure this thing out for himself. And so he's running it. So you see, again, the CIA connection. You have the Falcon running that operation. You have Jim Semivan running this operation. And then I leaked these documents. I haven't even got time to look at them yet. This is an eyes-only study. It was done for President Johnson. And in that one, you see a flowchart. It's exactly the same. You have two of the stars, and you have the eyes-only study, which had 8 people. You have Arthur Lundahl, the guy who ran the weird desk, the CIA UFO desk. And in the two of the stars, you have Kit Green, Ron Pandolfi, and Jim Semivan. And then you have Robert Weiss, the head of Lockheed Skunk Works, is in both programs. You have a general at the National Reconnaissance Organization in both programs. You have a high-level physicist in both programs. And then you have Neil McCaslin, who we mentioned already, the two-star general. In the eyes-only study for President Johnson, they had a 4-star general from Wright-Patterson. So it's almost like when you want to do some sort of UFO thing, you have to have these people on your board. It's the same pattern. Coleman also ran a UFO show 78, 77, 78. He ran a UFO show for 2 years doing Blue Book stuff. And it was indirect, drip, drip, running this UFO show. And this is the guy that controlled all these leaks. Here's Arthur Lundahl. He was the guy that briefed Kennedy on UFOs and also briefed him on the Cuban Missile Crisis. He was a photographic expert. He ran all the analysis of U2 SR-71 and spy photographs for the CIA.
But there was always a CIA courier, a guy with us. His name was Dick Besky. Plainclothesman. I have his card still. It just has a telephone number, you know. But Alan told me that what we were doing was more initiated by his organization than the Air Force. But the Air Force cooperated. So everybody, maybe there was curiosity somewhere, but they sure granted us every one of our wishes as far as I could see. And I'm not making this up, just the way it was.
So what you have is you have the semi-van running this one, you have the Falcon, and this goes back to 1975. This is my friend Bob Emmenegger. Bob Emmenegger ran a documentary called UFOs, Past, Present, and Future, and he says the CIA was on the set the entire time that they filmed this thing. So 1975, 88, now it's the same thing. You have a CIA guy who's operational in how this documentary is done. Tom DeLonge releases the book Secret Machines, Chasing Shadows in April of 2016, and he comes from San Diego. He tells a story that as soon as that book came out, he was contacted, I believe, by Jim Semivan, because Jim Semivan gives the same date for making contact with him, and he said he was taken to a hotel room in San Diego, and for 2 days in this hotel room, there was a half a dozen intelligence agents asking him, how did you get this, who were you talking to, and went through the whole thing, and they didn't arrest him, they just joined him. They said, okay, and then they started helping him as well. So you have the same thing, you have this CIA component to all these gradual leaks of material. Here's the CIA people on the To the Stars Academy thing. You can see piles of people on there that are CIA people. Now let's go to videos. This is the Nimitz video. This is from 2007. This was leaked 10 years before it appeared in the New York Times. And this video, and I'll show you how it connects to the past, when they released it in the New York Times, they only released a little piece of the video. This is the longer version of the video. And if you go back to, here's the New York Times with the Nimitz, and they were also shown documents. The New York Times was actually shown documents. Leslie Kane, when this thing was set up, this is from the New York Times, December 18th, Leslie Kane said, when the initial meeting took place, to give the story, she said, there were several present and former intelligence officers and a defense contractor in the room, as the New York Times was sitting in there. And I maintain it was just not the New York Times. I would maintain it was Politico went the same day, Washington Post went the same day, and the New York Times went the same day. And they all went, these are newspapers that don't do UFO stories. They all went on the same morning with the same story. They were all shown documents. They were all shown, and they were convinced that this thing was for real. So you have a bunch of people, the same thing, where you have all these intelligence officials on this latest thing. This is what Leslie wrote. The meeting took October 4th. This is a week before the news conference that they had. She said, I was shown documentation. I was shown videos that were released with our story. I was told about Harry Reid. I was shown documents about Harry Reid's involvement, and the story was kind of laid out for us. So all I had to do was go and check it. They basically were given the story. And the fact that all three newspapers went on the same day indicates that this was a coordinated effort. This was not something that all these major news media just suddenly decided they were going to do a UFO story. So the Washington Post breaks the story, and the thing that people forget is the Washington Post had a guy, did their article, had two Pulitzer Prizes. The guy that did the Politico one said that he was told by his Pentagon people when he was checking the story that there was multiple programs. The AATIP program was not the only program. There was other programs. So you have three newspapers all going at the same time. And then you have the thing, it's almost like the past, that when we try to verify it, then suddenly it all falls apart. So the story comes out, New York Times runs the story, and then we go and we try to get the videos, and the Pentagon says categorically, we did not release those videos. So, and then they say there's no records. We have no records of this program and no videos. So it's the same thing. You put the story out, you pull it back. Here's Bob Emmenegger talking about how he was approached in 1974 to do a documentary for the U.S. government.
And we went to Norton Air Force Base to discuss other things, among them three-dimensional moving holography and laser and cancer and all of the R&D, advanced research ARPA kind of project.
Okay.
And the UFO thing was brought up to us, which I just couldn't believe, but said, well, okay, we'll go along with it.
Uh-huh.
And one conversation led to another, a contact with the Pentagon. Everybody couldn't have been more open about what we were doing, and anyone along the line could have questioned and said, and I expected them to say, like, what the hell are you guys talking about?
What they were released during this thing, the Art Lundahl, who is the equivalent to Ron Pandolfi today, came to them, gave them a case that's on there. And if you want to look it up on the internet, it's called UFOs That Has Begun. And you can watch this whole documentary. What they were given was a channeling session where the CIA channels an alien in the National Photographic Interpretation Center. Arthur Lundahl gives them that story. And Emenegger says, can you go on camera? And Arthur Lundahl says, I can't. He said, you don't understand. And Bob says, what do you mean you don't understand? He said, I'm on duty. I can't go on camera. So they put the head of Blue Book on there, and he describes this sort of story. The other thing they offered them was the famous Holloman Air Force Base film that is supposedly rumored to be shown to the president when he gets a briefing. And here's Paul Schardel, and he's the guy that you heard him talking about. We were told to do these documentaries, and then the UFO thing. It was Paul Schardel, the security manager at Norton Air Force Base, who was making this offer. And he offers them the film. Later in 1988, in UFO Cover-Up Live documentary, he actually describes what was on the film.
I saw footage of three disc-shaped crafts. One of the craft landed and two of them went away.
Why did it land?
It appeared to be in trouble because it oscillated all the way down to the ground. However, it did land on three pods. A sliding door opened, a ramp was extended, and out came three aliens.
What did they look like?
Well, they were human-sized. They had odd gray complexion and a pronounced nose. They wore tight-fitting jumpsuits, thin headdresses that appeared to be communication devices, and in their hands, they held a translator, I was told. A Holloman base commander and other Air Force officers went out to meet them.
And it was filmed from four different vantage points. Linda Howe has been offered this film. Clifford Stone apparently had it for one day. This is kind of a famous sort of film that there's actually been an FOA by a senator in Washington trying to get this film. And Bob wasn't interested. That's what you got to realize. He was into the Comedy Channel. He used to tell his wife, Margaret, we could read that garbage UFO stuff. And suddenly he's in the middle of this thing where they're offering him this film. And so he didn't want to talk about UFOs. And I would interview him over the years. And then, well, here, let me do, he talks about the cooperation that they got.
And I kept thinking up, why did the Army cooperate? Why did the commander of the base cooperate? Everywhere, everything seemed to happen that way. You know, you ask for it, you're going to get it. So there was total cooperation as far as I could see.
They were given lots of film. You're seeing the story that To the Stars may release 24 films. Bob Emenegger, 1975, same story.
They would have let us have a lot of things. We previewed all kinds of film, and there was no restriction on whether to use it or not use it.
In fact, they actually have a film. They pulled a Holloman film, almost like the Disney thing. They pulled a Holloman film back at the very last second, and then there was another film that had to do with a launch at Vandenberg, and these UFOs are around the launch, and they have it analyzed and all this sort of stuff. And they didn't put it into the documentary. And I said to him, I said, well, did they pull that film back? And he went, no, I don't think. I think we still got that. And I said, you still got the film? He said, yeah, it was top secret. It had Quentin Null's name. I think Alan Sandler still has it in the vault. Found out he does. And James Fox was negotiating for that film. So there's still some film that was released in the 70s that's still floating around. This is what happened. They pulled a film. And then it's almost like the Nimitz film. So they take a little clip of the Nimitz film and they release that, and then they say the rest is classified. It's probably going to be classified. That's why they didn't release the film. What I found out was that in the documentary, UFOs It Has Begun, there's 8 seconds of the film in the documentary. So I went to Bob and I said, Bob, you told me the film was pulled back to the Pentagon. He said, yeah, it was pulled. And he told me the whole story about these people driving it in this Datsun across the country and stuff. I said, but Bob, there's 8 seconds of film in the documentary. And he went, well, yeah. And I said, but you said it was pulled. He said, well, it didn't show anything. Oh, no, he said it was background. And I said, what do you mean it was background? And he said, well, it didn't show anything. And that's the whole point. The classified part is when it lands and the beings get out of the craft, So here's the 8 seconds of film from the actual documentary. And they put in voices in the background, too, because they're putting it in a documentary. But here's the actual 8 seconds as the craft is coming into Holloman.
This is Holloman Air Force Base Control Tower. Identify yourself. What's your tail number? You're encroaching on military airspace.
So again, Bob, you have to drag stuff out of him because he's really not interested in it. So I talked to him at one point and I said, you know, Bob, the strange thing is, if you look at this documentary, if it weren't for the location and the fact that it was at night in the morning instead of at night, this looks like Close Encounters of the Third Kind. And he went, what? I didn't tell you? And I said, no, you didn't tell me what? I didn't tell you I gave a copy to Steven Spielberg? And I said, no, you didn't tell me that. He said, I told you. Annie Spielberg, his sister, worked as a line producer for us. And she said Steven wants a copy of the film. So 1975, he gives Steven a copy of the video, and then you see the three objects, just like the Holloman film, showing up. You have these people already. The cameras are all going. It's exactly the same story, and Steven put it in. And what Bob told me, it was after the Close Encounters came out, Steven Spielberg's mother came and said, Steven, or Bob, I've seen your version of the landing, and I've seen Steven's version of the landing, and I like Steven's version better. In the documentary, you start looking at Close Encounters of the Third Kind, you see Rockwell International. All these letters to the director of Close Encounters wanting to put their stuff in. And you see all the main characters. Rockwell International is putting their stuff in there. And then you see on Close Encounters, as the UFO is getting ready to land, you got these people with these boxes with Rockwell on the side. And then you see this jump team that was supposed to get on the craft and go to the other planet or whatever, the whole Project Serpo stuff. It's got Project Mayflower. And then if you go farther, then you see that Rockwell International is the proud partner in Project Mayflower. And they're actually selling t-shirts that you can buy. And that's in the documentary. This Project Mayflower is where they were going to send the astronauts on the flying saucer. I'll skip this. This is a core story. This is the whole idea that they came up with a core story in 1986. As to the fact that there's been a recovered craft, we're not doing very well back engineering this thing. And here's the one from Lockheed. And of course, Lockheed is rumored to be the one that back engineers the flying saucer. They were involved in Close Encounters of the Third Kind as well. You can see just before the craft lands, there's some guy running around with a crate with Lockheed on the side. And in the new program, the Tom DeLonge program, Robert Weiss, who's the head of Lockheed Skunk Works, is actually in the program. And as a bizarre thing happens in the WikiLeaks thing, there's a memo. So they have a big meeting. John Podesta is running this meeting. The two generals and Robert Weiss, the head of Lockheed Skunk Works, are in this meeting January 25th, 2016, and it's about UFO disclosure. And they have this meeting, and John Podesta must have promised to do something. And the weird thing was, John Podesta in the Clinton administration was a big X-Files. He said it didn't matter what was happening in the White House. When X-Files was on, he went home to watch X-Files. So he was known as the X-Files man in the Clinton White House. And he said in one interview during the Clinton administration, he actually phoned Area 51 to see what was going on. And then you have this situation. So now John is the top guy, and this is what the letter says. Weiss from Lockheed Skunk Works. This is DeLonge writing to Podesta. Weiss from Lockheed Skunk Works just emailed me asking if there are any updates. So basically, in 1990s, John Podesta is phoning Lockheed or Area 51 to find out what's going on. In 2016, Lockheed at Area 51 is phoning John Podesta to find out what's going on. And so you have this sort of involvement. TRW was also involved. And then I mentioned this already about the film. 1985, they get another offer. They do the documentary in the 1970s, and then Bob gets approached in 1985 to do another documentary. They liked what you do in the 70s. We want you to do another UFO documentary. Oh, I don't have the audio. And what happens, so I'll skip the audios here. What happens is J. Allen Hynek and Jacques Vallée have to be part of the program. So what they had was they were brought in, they said you have to do this thing, but Hynek and Vallée have to be part of the program. Otherwise, we're not going to release. And Linda Howe says that Hynek told her they were going to release pictures of bodies, they were going to release everything. And they actually Bob actually tells a story that the guy who was running the Norton base where they keep all the film and stuff actually had brought Hynek into the room. And he said to Paul Schartel, the security manager, he said, okay, start pulling the film for Hynek. Show Hynek the film. And then the guy said, I'm sorry, General, you'll need a requisition. You'll need a written request for that. And he said, God damn, I'll have your ass. Start pulling the film. And this sort of battle broke out. And Heineken Valley actually pulled out because they realized what had happened in the 1970s, where the film was all pulled back, and with Disney and this sort of stuff. And Jacques Vallée called the dangling carrot. They weren't going to grab the dangling carrot because they didn't want to get dragged in. The strange thing is Valley is now part of the Tom DeLonge operation. So I don't know. Now he's trying to grab the carrot, I guess. I don't know.
Well, anyway, after Heineck...
I've described that one. Coleman actually stated, and this is a rumor, Billy Cox told me this as well. Bill Coleman actually had 100 cases. Before he died, he was threatening he was going to drop a bunch of stuff. And he actually ended up dying. We had heard this story that he had this stuff, and he was saying he was ready to drop this material into the public, but he ended up dying. Here's the flow chart that was shown in 1988. The only thing I'll mention on this, I think it's a pretty accurate flow chart, but what I'll mention is this is 1988 documentary. On the right-hand side, you have Area 51 on the bottom right-hand corner. Area 51 would not become known until 1989. This is October of 88. It was May of 1989 when the Area 51 story broke, when Bob Lazar went on TV in Las Vegas. The other one is the Parapsychology Research Unit in the bottom left-hand corner, and that would not be declassified until 1995. So it's already on a flow chart in a documentary on American TV in 1988. Documents. There's a new document that's just been released, a letter from Harry Reid. 1980s, the Majestic 12 document was out there, and it's the same as the documents now. This is a document that was released. It was called the Executive Summary, and everybody in ufology realized the document's been altered. The headers and the footers have been taken off. It's the same thing. It's the same story. The document is released, but nobody can verify the document. You can't actually find the document, but the material is leaking out. This is a document in the Bill Moore days. This is a document that cost Bill Moore's career. The document was altered. He had seen the document before he was altered. Then he was told to pass the altered document to Paul Benowitz. His career was over. Now it's like you can put altered documents and nobody seems to really worry about it. This is it's kind of an important thing, and this has to do with the New York Times, because all three newspapers go, and yet we can't get any material on it. We're stymied. We can't get the videos. We can't get any confirmation. This is a court ruling that favored the CIA can release classified material to reporters and then refuse it in an FOIA. So the New York Times, Washington Post, and Political would not have gone with the story unless they got a confirmation from inside the Pentagon that this story was for real. They got a confirmation, they got to see the documents, and we didn't get to see the documents, and this is what this court case is about, that they claim they can actually do this. You can give it to the reporter and then refuse it in FOIA and say it doesn't exist. The Black Vault, this has got to do with the name of the program. I'll skip over some of this. If you take a look at the name, we even have problems with the name. New York Times used aerospace, Lou Elizondo uses aerospace. The defense spokesman says, no, no, it's not aerospace, it's aviation, Advanced Aviation Threat Identification Program. The Washington Post uses aviation, and Politico used aviation. So all three people have got sources inside the Pentagon, and they're leaking two different names to these newspapers, and it creates this mass confusion. So John Greenwald is trying to get an interview with Lou Elizondo, and on May 21st, they turned it down. For 3 months, he tried to get an interview with Elizondo to find out what's the name of the program, because Elizondo appeared to be using the wrong name, and on May the 21st, they said, sorry, there'd be no interview with Elizondo. We can't let you interview him. So you have this confusion over the names. Now, as to books, you have Tom DeLonge is releasing 6 books, 3 fiction, 3 nonfiction. You go back. Bob Pratt, my friend that came to Manitoba to do the Charlie Red Star story, 1981. We finally agreed that we couldn't prove any of this kind of stuff. So we decided to write up in a nonfiction book. We'd agree to write a novel. We put all this crap in there and pass it off, described as fiction. So they had all this MJ-12. Moore was getting all this material from the government, and they really couldn't do anything, so they were going to write a book, same as Tom DeLonge. You fictionalize the actual story, turn it into a fiction thing, put it out, and the ideas get, you know, into the public. Same as Chase Brandon. Chase Brandon was the Hollywood liaison for the CIA for 10 years. He had second most powerful person to speak publicly on behalf of the CIA. He comes out and he says, it was not a damn weather balloon. And he basically says, Roswell was real. It was extraterrestrial and there were bodies. He said his book was reviewed a couple of times, and his book was about how the CIA handled the Roswell affair, and he said if you want to read a good book, read the book. If you want to learn something, read between the lines. And this is how they do it. They fictionalize the stuff. If you're a spy, you want to tell your story, you can do it. You just got to fictionalize the story. Remote viewing. This is where it shows you how this all ties together. I believe it's called phenomenology. It's not just UFOs. It's remote viewing. It's psychic phenomena. It's psychokinesis. It's all the same thing. And the CIA refers to it as phenomenology. So you have this situation in 1989. The remote viewing program was in the same bad situation as the UFO situation, where we can't get any credibility, we can't get any respect. And the remote viewing program was in the Defense Intelligence Agency, and they wanted it out. They wanted this program gone. So they were going to cancel the program. And then Cohen, who was the head of the Intelligence Committee, and Byrd's assistant, was Dick D'Amato. Dick D'Amato, if you hear the story at Citizens Hearing, he tells Jesse Marcel, he taps on the book Majestic, which is about the Majestic 12 and about the Roswell crash, and he said, I just want to let you know, this ain't fiction. This is for real. There's a dark arm of the government that is unelected, that has unlimited amounts of money. They control the data. And so Dick D'Amato was in this meeting in 1989 where they're going to try to save the remote viewing program. So you have Cohen, you have this D'Amato lawyer guy in there, and he's representing the Appropriations Committee because they're going to put the money up. And then what happens is you have D'Amato, and then suddenly you get Inouye, Stevens, and Glenn. The same three senators who authorized the money for the AATIP program also authorized money for a remote viewing program in 1989, saved the remote viewing program. And so then we get to a clip, a very interesting clip here, because we've only got 4 minutes. Let's go back.
I'm so sorry, now, Senator Glenn.
Well, let's go back. Okay, so this, you look at this again and you say, oh, you see it in a new light. So you know Glenn saved the remote viewing program. He's into remote viewing, he's into UFOs. Then you see he appears on Fraser. So the question is what you're going to see here made up? Is it a comedy, or are they actually trying to drop a hint? Here's Glenn on the Fraser show.
I am so sorry, Senator Glenn.
Well, I'm the one that's sorry. It's my nature to be honest and
now listen up, Ross. I'm going to tell you what I did this for.
Back in those glory days, I was very uncomfortable when they asked us to say things that I didn't want to say and deny other things.
I am so mad at you, Fraser.
Oh, yeah? Well, I'm mad too, so just bring it on.
Some people ask, you know, were you alone out there? We never gave the real answer, and yet we've seen things out there, strange things.
This is my project, and I asked you not to try to take control, and now you've gone behind my back and done just that.
But Roger didn't even give me a fair shake.
Well, if I didn't, it was because I was trying to protect myself, because you can be so bossy sometimes.
But we know what we saw out there, and we couldn't really say anything, and the bosses were scared of this. They were afraid of War of the Worlds type stuff, and about panic in the streets, and so we had to keep quiet, and now we only see these things in our, well, in our nightmares, or maybe in the movies, and some of them are pretty close to being the truth.
All right, Roz. I'll admit that maybe I was being a little too assertive, all right? But the least you could do is admit that perhaps you were a bit defensive.
Maybe you're right, but it was because I was trying to prove that I could do this on my own, so I was shutting you out. I admit it. It was unfair, and I apologize.
Accepted. Oh, Ross, come on. Our friendship is much more important to me than this documentary.
Oh, it is to me, too, Fraser.
Look, about what I just said out there, can we just keep that between us?
Oh, of course, Senator.
Good. Well, oh, wait. You were recording all that?
Well, yeah, but that's okay. We've got plenty of tape.
I'm going to need that tape.
Live alien story, late 1980s, piles of people. Whitley Strieber, Linda Howe, Bob Emmenegger were all offered interviews with a live alien. And Bob said to me, he said, well, that's garbage. And I said, well, who offered it to you? He said, Paul Schartle. And I said, well, do you think Paul was reliable? He said, oh, yeah, he was reliable. So you had these kind of things. And then the old idea, there was George Knapp was told the story by an insider, high-level guy inside Area 51, that they did have a live alien, and they were afraid it was going to escape. And suddenly you have the movie Paul, where the alien escapes from Area 51 shortly after that. Now, disclosure stuff, held put off in this is a couple weeks ago at the remote viewing conference. They said this, I'll skip this one. He said, he was asked, why does John Alexander said he's talked to all the high-level people in all the three later agencies, why was he not able to get anything? And Putoff said, if materials are being held in special access programs, casual conversation, even with high-level people who know your interest, and they're interested too, won't necessarily release the facts. So John Alexander didn't have a clearance. Plus, I was told that he didn't have anything they needed, so he wasn't brought into the program. So that's why Putoff never told him what was going on. He says, we had in this thing, he said, the Soviet Union had a massive program, and he shows a document. And so the whole point is, we know what the Russians are doing. We know the Russians had this massive program, but we didn't know what's going on in our own government. They knew, there's no doubt that we know what's going on in our government. They're trying to make it like we don't, but they know that the Russians have this program and put off the scene the documents. Eric Davis said, this is just last week, he talks about the fact that there was a crash saucer program. 1989, it was defunded because they couldn't really back engineer anything. And that's when George Knapp says, well, I know what the story is going to be for tomorrow. So they're out there, they're dropping this kind of stuff. And most people, it skips by, I pick up on this stuff. Here's the two programs. There's a Paul Murad, there's a major funding thing. He's got one of these energy device things. CIA is backing that. I was told by the engineer, CIA is backing Firmage. And then I want to go to the last thing. Confirmation versus disclosure. What I believe has happened, Bob Bigelow did an interview in 2013, and in that interview he was asked by George Knapp, are you in favor of disclosure? He said, no, I'm not. I'm in favor of confirmation. What you need to do is you need to put out the story to the American people that this phenomena is real, and stop right there. That's exactly what they did in December. They dropped the thing, UFOs are real, we're working on it, we're not saying it's extraterrestrial, we're not saying it's alien, and Bigelow said that comes a couple of years down the road. My only reservation about what's happening now is that it's being identified as a threat identification program. And if it has been determined, and it will be by somebody in the military, that 1% of these crafts are dangerous, they're evil, they're whatever, they're going to be shooting everything down. And that's the reservation I have about disclosure, is that it's being spun. Even Eric Davis said the other night, they are interfering with our military operations, and we've got to do something about it. And so I leave you with a story that was told by Frank Edwards, who had 10 million listeners on radio in the 1950s. He tells a story that in 1952, there was the overflight of Washington, and Truman gave a shoot down order. And the next week, the week before they came back, everybody was emailing, or not emailing, but sending telexes to Truman. Don't shoot down the UFOs. Don't shoot them down. Don't shoot them down. And he tells a story. He said, I don't know who all went there, but I know that Einstein went to see the president. And Albert Einstein said to the president, Mr. President, any civilization that can come across millions of miles of space will know what to do to protect themselves once they get here. Don't start something you can't finish. And he said, that was the first time Give Him Hell Harry decided it would be better not to give him any hell. And I have the same reservation that we may be in a situation where we're going to be stupid enough to think that we're going to go to war against something out there. We've got enough war here, we should stop. So that's where I leave it. The warning that there is some, every release has its good and its bad side. And this thing, the military has the money, the military is spinning this thing as a threat identification program. And that's my big reservation about disclosure. Thanks. Thank you.
You just wind him up and he keeps on going. Amazing. Thank you very much, Grant. Excellent. We have some information that we've created somewhat of a tweet storm. But for those of you who want to get involved in that tweet storm, in here in the room, there's a Wi-Fi setup. It's called Sheraton Hotels Meetings, and the password is Wi-Fi 2018. So if you want to become part of that whole storm, and I was told by someone in the audience, and what I know about tweeting, you could fit in a flea's navel and still have room for three caraway seeds. So I don't really know a whole lot about it. You liked it, eh, Sarah? You can do your hashtag ANP conference, and you can do that. We are going to come back in, 10 minutes? And we will, is that about right? Yeah, about 10 minutes, so we'll introduce the next speaker at that time. Okay, thank you.